Number four of the 96-97 council year to order. Could we have the roll call by the town clerk, please?
Chairman McLaughlin.
Here.
Council Cogsall.
Here.
Council Groff.
Here.
Council Jordan.
Here.
Council Linnell.
Here.
Council McGinty.
Here.
And Council Reed.
Here.
Thank you. Would you please join me in the pledge to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this point on the agenda, we have citizens' discussion period of items that are not on this evening's agenda. Is there anybody who wishes to make such a comment this evening? Seeing none, we will move along. The next item is reports and correspondence from the council. Do we have any? Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I would like to bring to the public's attention the school study committee has given a progress or interim report to the town council, the school board dated June 30th as requested.
And in that pool study report, we discussed the pool condition, the fact that we have considered the direct hiring of an aquatics consultant, but we have determined that this will be something that the contractor gets to do, the architect or engineer probably when we make that decision. We had a survey in the Cape Courier. We received well over 180 responses to that, and I thank all those who took the time to respond. Also, we will be meeting to determine the qualifications for the architects and the engineers, and we will be making an updated report to the council in September.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? A few things I want to mention. A couple of weeks ago, the town council put on a cookout for the town employees as a combination recognition and thank you day, and had a wonderful turnout, and even had former councilor Irv Chappell joining us wielding his spatula, as he does very well. We have received a letter from the U.S. Department of Agriculture referencing a 12-acre parcel at the on the east side of the Sawyer Road with its intersection with Fickett Street. And this is a parcel currently owned by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. They are considering transferring that ownership to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. They have a comment period that ends July 19th. If anybody would like more information, they can get in touch with the manager's office on that. Okay.
Yeah, it would be helpful if it was sooner rather than later, so
yes,
that we're not faced with an immediate deadline.
Okay.
The USDA.
And any the counselors all have information about that that are received in their packets. A week ago Sunday, some of us were in attendance. We had a dedication ceremony at Fort Williams. There are now two very nice, wonderful, comfortable benches down by the pond dedicated in memory of Ron Fritz. I encourage you all to go down there and enjoy some peaceful sitting time. Add that to your lives. It's a beautiful setting. There will be a planting of rhododendrons behind the benches, between the benches and the tennis court area. On Thursday, July 11th, which is this coming Thursday, a reminder to the council, there will be a caucus of concerning the Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee. Our Councilor Jordan is a member of that committee at this time. And on Wednesday evening this week at 7 p.m. in the town council cafeteria in the basement, where it hopefully will be cool, the council and the planning board will have a joint review meeting working on review of the zoning ordinance. My understanding, Councilor Jordan, from a conversation we had today is that there was no regional waste systems meeting since our last meeting, so there was no report. Is that accurate?
That's correct.
That right? Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on in the agenda, we have a consent calendar tonight, consent agenda with two items. Item number 29 for the council year is a malt, vinous, and spiritus license for the Good Table Incorporated. Item number 30 is approval of Public Safety Day at Fort Williams Park on October 12, 1996. Does any councilor wish to remove either of those for discussion? Sorry, I skipped the minutes.
Yeah.
We need to go. Thank you, Councilor Jordan. You were right on top of that. Let's back up here. Minutes of meetings number 1, number 2, and number 3. These were held on June 10th, June 24th, and June 25th. Do we have a motion on the minutes? Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move acceptance of the minutes.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Back to the consent agenda. The license for the Good Table and approval of Public Safety Day at Fort Williams Park on October 12, 1996. Does any council wish to remove either of those for discussion? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion for approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
Second. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 31, recommendations from the Cable Committee to allocate $7,000 in franchise fee income to enable the school department to purchase equipment for a video technology program. Mr. McGovern, do we have information on that?
Yes, both Grace Myers and Jim Ray are both here. Grace Myers representing the Cable Television Advisory Commission and Jim Ray representing the Cable Elizabeth High School. One of the town council goals for this past year has been to increase the school use of our cable television resources. We've been very fortunate that we've had a number of talented students who've been helping us out over the years, but it'd be really helpful to have a couple of more things, more students being trained all the time. Not only can they can help us, but for career potential, as well as for the school to develop its own resources to do some of its own broadcasting of programs. What's come before you is a proposal that was developed working very closely with Jim Ray, with Rick Tuchusko, the high school principal, with Joyce Bell, who's the high school librarian, as well as with Ryan McKisson, of looking at how we could really get this off the ground. And Grace and Jim are here to explain the details of it. The proposal basically is that we allocate $7,000 from the franchise fee income from Time Warner Cable that they provide through the cable subscribers in order to fund some equipment to get them up off the ground. And Grace is here to relate anything additional she would like from the cable committee.
Great, thank you. Ms. Myers, Mr. Ray, do you want to come and give us some information if you have for us?
As Mr. McGovern mentioned, we'd like to start an audio-video technology program down at the high school and work towards producing programming from the high school, not only involving the high school but also the community. And we'd like to produce the programs to help convey various different things that are going on in the school, both athletically and academically and so forth. I understand that there was a question or a concern regarding safety of the equipment. All I can say is we are currently revamping the lab and developing a studio room, which is a room within a lab, which is always locked. We have been doing some work on a minor level for the last year and a half. To date, we've had no problems securing that equipment that we have currently. I'd be happy to address any questions.
Are there questions from the council for Mr. Ray? If not, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Myers?
After we discussed Jim's plan, there was pretty much unanimous support for the proposal contingent on the insurance that the equipment would be safe. One of our members relayed a few stories of equipment that had walked off in the computer labs in the library. We just want to make sure that if the investment is protected.
Very good. Thank you. I'd like to entertain a motion, and then we can have discussion. Councilor Reed?
Madam Chairman, I move that we follow the recommendation of the Cable Television Advisory Commission regarding the $7,000 to enable the school department to purchase equipment for the video technology program.
Second motion.
Thank you. Discussion? Counselor Coxon?
I'm greatly encouraged to see that the schools are finally going to be able to have this opportunity. We've wanted the schools to participate in our local cable access, and for some reason or other, it's never really developed. But last year, the push began, and I have to really thank Ryan and a very proactive cable committee for starting this program.
Thank you. Anybody else? Counselor Jordan?
I ditto what Counselor Coxon passed on, and I just would like to say one thing to the committee is that it doesn't pass out too many keys because sometimes that gets out of hand.
Point well taken, I'm sure. Anybody else? Councilor Nell?
Yeah, I just want to point out this is coming out of the franchise fee, so this is it's in something of a freebie, is it not?
I believe.
And this isn't coming out of the general fund. This is coming out of what the cable company pays the town of Cape Elizabeth. So it seems, since they're paying the bill, it seems like a worthy, particularly worthy way to use the money.
Thank you. Anybody else? We have a motion. We have a second. End of discussion. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? 7-0. Thank you. At this point, I would like to bring to the council's attention, you did have before you this evening an application for boards and committees. We will be entertaining at the end of the regular agenda an item out of order, item number 43, for an appointment to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. That's why that was before you this evening. At this point, we will be having a public hearing. We have four items that will be covered in the public hearing. These are items 32 through 34. And I think that's why we have a lot of these people in the audience tonight. We're very glad you're joining us. Before we get started with the public hearing, a few things I'd like to cover. We have some potential ground rules, one of which is on the ground. Councilor Coxall, could you go down there and put that one back up? Or somebody who's close over there?
Let me get it.
Somebody close. Thank you.
Thank you.
Giving somebody some exercise. Thank you very much. I would like for the council just to have a quick, review of the proposed ground rules and see if we have any editing to do to them. Number one, discuss issues, not personalities. Avoid redundancy. Everyone gets to speak once before anyone speaks a second time. The bottom one would be an active listener. Proposed format is 10 minutes. Intro, summation, whatever you want to do. New information, statements from the advocates to be followed by 10 minutes of similar time given to those who have expressed questions or concerns about the proposals in the past or have questions and concerns about the proposals as they are being presented this evening. And then thereafter, all speakers would have 1 minute of speaking time. In that we would have proponents, we would have advocates, and then those with concerns. We want to alternate between the two. Questions, comments from the council? Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, these ground rules for the council regarding avoid redundancy, everyone gets to speak once before another speaks a second time. Are we asking the general public to also avoid redundancy? And how are we going to measure that if that's the case?
The intent was that these are ground rules for the public hearing. They would apply to the public as well as to the council. And I would entertain help from councilors in feeling out redundancies. Councilor Linnell, excuse me, is that answering? Councilor Linnell?
Yeah, is it clear for the 10 minutes, proponents and opponents? I mean, is that clear who they are? Is everyone in the 10-minute category, or is that just?
I can tell you the work I did ahead of time on that. I made 5 phone calls, two to people who have been declared advocates, I guess you would say, in the past, and three to people who we know have been expressed concerns in the past.
So they know who they are.
And ask them to use that time accordingly, and I was assured by them that they would be in contact with other people of similar feelings.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that they know who they are so that, in other words, that everyone doesn't feel that they're going to do a 10-minute.
Right. I believe they have prepared statements, and
okay. We'll
hope it works that way. And then, as is noted, everybody who wants a chance to speak will have a chance to speak. Anything else on the ground rules or the format? From the audience, would you come to the microphone, please?
My question is, the time frames, do they refer to all four issues being taken at once, or are we doing one item at a time?
Thank you. The intent is to take all four issues at once. I think that's going to save us some repeated trips to the microphone for people. The one-minute time frame was assuming that there might be more people than this in the audience, and I think we will be a bit lenient with that. I'm not about to cut anybody off in mid-sentence or mid-thought. Any other questions or comments? Before we get started, I will read through for everybody what the language of the items consists of. Okay, if you are in the town hall audience this evening, there are copies of the items on the back table if you want to avail yourself of that. For the public who we believe sometimes watch, I want to go through some of the information. To start with, I think it would be helpful to know where we are as of June 24th. That was the last time this council met in a public session on this issue. At that time, we had a workshop meeting, we had a facilitator, and basically we're trying to get a sense of the council in four different areas. First was whether or not to construct more playing fields. If so, where those fields should be located, a general outline of how the fields should be funded, and getting into details of how one or two of the fields could be done. In that session, we came up with a prioritized list built upon information that had been prepared from us by OST Associates and their engineering review of two sites in particular, came up with what was a combination of two of the possibilities put forth in that report. The top preference was for one Little League type baseball field at Lions Field and an east-west oriented multi-purpose field that could accommodate field hockey, soccer, lacrosse at the tenting area, former tenting ground area of Fort Williams at a cost estimated that evening of $255,000. The second priority that evening was a Little League field and an east-west oriented field hockey, lacrosse, soccer field combination at Fort Williams in the tenting ground area for a cost of $148,000 and change. The sense of the group that evening was that it wanted to proceed with the top two priorities and questioned some of the others, but basically was satisfied with the top two priorities being fairly accurate. The council that evening also very strongly stated that it would continue to look for additional sites for fields as part of an overall look at future recreation needs for the town. This is part of an upcoming goal of the council that will be discussed later in this evening's agenda. There was also a strong sense of the council that we need to move forward on the process to change the 250-foot setback requirement from wetlands within the town's ordinances. This would have an impact on the proposal of the field at Lions Field by if the wetland setback was reduced from 250 to 100 feet, it would enhance the ability to locate a field at Lions Field. On the question of funding at that workshop, there were four primary areas that were brought up: donations, both cash and in-kind, town funds, both operating funds and capital funds, as well as town work, user fees from non-school users, and grants from both governmental programs and from private foundations. I think that's a fairly good summary of what we accomplished in our last session. My sense is that it would be helpful to do a brief outline of where we've been, now that we know about where we are. How did we get here? And this work, some of you are probably thinking this has been going on for a long time, and you're absolutely correct in that thinking. We're into our third council year of dealing with this issue. In the beginning, in the council year of 94-95, when Councilor Jordan was chairman, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission reviewed a proposal from a private group about a combined Little League field, multi-purpose field, on the former tenting ground area at Fort Williams. That commission recommended that area was recommended in the Fort Williams Master Plan that was adopted by the council in December of 1990. Fort Williams Advisory Commission recommended fields in that location with some conditions and with a revised layout of the field, recommending that it have an east-west orientation. That is what was coming out as the council's top priority in our workshop session a couple of weeks ago. During that council year, the town council authorized fundraising by the private group. It also authorized a grant application, and it referred the proposal to the planning board. The planning board conducted their review, and they recommended the town council approve the construction of the combination Little League field to multi-purpose field with a number of conditions. There was a private appeal to owners of large tracts of property to see if there were any other feasible playing field locations within the community. And the town council had a discussion about the issue at its May meeting of 1995. We started the 1995-96 council year in June of 95 under the chairmanship of Councilor Cogshaw. At that June meeting, there was a public hearing on the item that was quite extensive, and there was a motion made to approve the construction of the fields. There was a 3-3 vote, and when we have a tie vote, the motion is defeated. That was the result of that meeting. Subsequent to that, there was a town council goal during the last council year to identify and plan for community recreation needs. When we have town council goals, we have them shepherded by two councilors. The two councilors who took charge of that goal were Councilor Cogshaw and former Councilor Irv Chapel. Last August, the council had a workshop where we looked at the playing field use inventory and had that many pages to go through of how extensively used our current playing fields are, what groups use them, what time of year they use them, and even down to generally the day of the month that they were using them. That really hit home for the council the great need for additional playing fields. The council at that time directed the manager to prepare an inventory of municipal properties that would be feasible for playing field use. He finished that, I believe, in October, and at that time, Councilors Cogshaw and Chapel took the manager's information and did their own analysis and made recommendations to the full council. The fields that were considered were Lions Field, the Refuse Disposal Area, the Thomas Jordan Land, out back of Town Hall, in Fort Williams Park, there were three separate areas that were looked at. The entrance field, when you drive into the fort, the entrance field is on your left. The parade ground, which is where there is one existing softball, Little League softball field, I believe, and the concrete bleachers. And the third area was what was called the maintenance building, which is the former tenting ground area. Those are all of the municipal properties that were considered potentially appropriate for construction of playing fields. In January of this year, the council had a workshop at which there was a draft proposal reviewed about improvements to town-owned land and buildings and the kind of procedures that would need to be followed, and those, I think, we'll be thankful that we have in place in the long run. There was also a discussion of the ball field feasibility report. That discussion was followed up at the February council meeting when the council authorized the engineering study, eventually done by Oast Associates, and pinpointed two locations to be included in that study. One location was Lions Field, the other was the tenting grounds area at Fort Williams, and asked for a good combination of types of fields. Two little league fields, a little league multi-purpose field, a multi-purpose field. Here's the mix, juggle them together, see what comes up to be feasible. And in May of this year, of 96, we received the report. Now we're into our third council year. As you've heard, we had a workshop on this item on June 24th where we had a facilitator help get us to some consensus and conclusions. On tonight's agenda, we have four items, and I've probably totally mixed up my papers. Nope. Okay. And these, as the question was asked from the audience, these will be the four items to be addressed during the public hearing. Consideration of playing field sites, consideration of playing field funding alternatives. Number 34 is consideration to reauthorize the town to accept private funds for playing fields, and 35 is consideration of authorization to design playing fields. The anticipated process is that after this evening's public hearing, there will be council discussion. We need to then consider sending proposals to the Fort Williams Commission and to the Planning Board, asking them to have their comments back to this council by September 1st with anticipated final public hearing and vote of the council on the items at its September 9th meeting. It is not anticipated at this time that there is going to be a final vote on these items this evening, but that the final vote would be in September. For your information, and I apologize for talking so much, but I guess sometimes it's necessary evil. I want everybody to be aware of what is being considered this evening. Under consideration of playing field sites, the draft proposal in front of the council, and this is what would be submitted to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and to the Planning Board. There is also, of course, the potential and possibility for amendments to be made to these before the council takes its final vote this evening. The draft in front of us reads, ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby approve the planned use of Lions Field for an additional ball field to be built in conformance with design standards for Little League Baseball. The ball field is to be situated as shown in drawing alternate 2 in the report entitled Youth Recreational Ball Field Study at Lions Field as prepared by Oast Associates in May 1996. The field to be designed is the easterly of the two fields. We're talking about just one Little League field at this time, shown on the drawing, and any final design shall include sufficient parking. This order is contingent upon partial funding of the construction of the field as provided in a subsequent town council order and upon site plan approval from the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. Be it further ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council approves the proposed multi-purpose playing field in Fort Williams Park in the approximate location set forth in alternate 4 for Fort Williams Park of the Youth Recreational Ball Field Study as prepared by Oast Associates in May of 1996. I want to reiterate there is we are considering in this order only a multi-purpose field at Fort Williams. It does not include a Little League field in that location at Fort Williams. Based upon the following findings and subject to the following condition, findings, Fort Williams Advisory Commission and Cape Elizabeth Planning Board each recommended on June 1, 1995 and May 17, 1995 respectively with conditions, the approval of a proposed multi-purpose playing field in substantially the same location. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council on July 8, 1996 referred back to the Commission and to the Board a slightly revised layout and a minimized scope for further review and recommendations. Further recommendations were received on whatever. Number two, the multipurpose athletic field will provide a greatly needed field for recreational use by both organized teams and others, and is found to be a, quote, recreational use, unquote, and, quote, park use, unquote, as described in section 19-2-7 sub C sub 1, which is part of our code of ordinances relating to Fort Williams Park. Number three, the multipurpose athletic field is found to be consistent with the long-term plans of the town for the park, as described in section 19-2-7 sub C sub 1, including specifically by both text and plans with the Fort Williams Mass Park Master Plan dated November 1990. Number four, notwithstanding any ambiguity created by minor errors in the presently presented text of section 19-2-7C, the Town Council finds the provision was intended to provide and hereby interprets such section to mean that the Town Council may approve a use for the park if it is found by the Town Council to be a recreational or park use consistent with the town's long-term plans for the park under section 19-2-7C1. If the proposed use is not found by the Town Council to be a recreational or park use consistent with the town's long-term plans for the park, then it needs to consider the proposed use under the remaining provisions of section 19-2-7C, subsections 2 through 5. This is clear from a reading of the whole section, the provisions as originally printed and adopted by the Town Council, and the clearly expressed desire to subject non-recreational, non-park uses to more strict scrutiny, particularly addressing whether such non-recreational or non-park uses may impact negatively upon other uses within the park and upon the neighboring residential neighborhood. However, having made the above determination that the proposed use is a park or recreation use, consistent with the long-term plans of the town for the park, and that section 19-2-7C1 only must be met as to such a park or recreational use, the Town Council further finds the proposed multipurpose athletic field meets the standards of section 19-2-7, 2 through 5 specifically. A, the area of the park in which the field shall be located is not now improved for park or recreational use, and for the period contemplated by such proposed use, I imagine, the area of the park is not anticipated to become the subject of any viable proposal for park or recreational improvements. The proposed use will not interfere with or detract from park and recreational uses then existing or anticipated during the period of such use. The proposed use will be compatible with and will not detract from the attributes and values of the residentially zoned properties adjacent to the park. The proposed use will be consistent with the active recreational use of Ship Cove and with the possible recreational use of the remaining shoreline within the park. This is followed by conditions. All parking for the proposed field shall be in the existing central parking lot or in the parking lot behind the two rented Officers Row buildings. There is no additional parking lot contemplated. Motor vehicles shall not be permitted in the area immediately adjacent to the field except for mowing and maintenance equipment, snow plows, and for the drop-off of athletic equipment. Any vehicle used to drop off equipment shall not be left parked in the immediate area adjacent to the field. Vehicles may continue to traverse through the area during special events when a one-way system is established by the police department with Fort Williams Park. There shall be no sound amplification for any event in the field area. Number four, there shall be no lighting for any event in the field area. Number five, there shall be no electrical power brought to the field area. Number six, there shall be no fixed or permanently installed bleachers. Number seven, soccer goalposts shall be movable. Number eight, all use of the field area shall commence no earlier than 9 a.m. and shall end by dusk. Number nine, scheduling use of the field shall be done on a day-to-day basis by the Community Services Department. First preference shall be given to Cape Elizabeth-based youth soccer, field hockey, and lacrosse groups. The field shall not be used for any industrial league, nor for any interscholastic games except in an emergency. It is the intent that the field shall be for Cape Elizabeth youth. Any scheduled activity using the field shall have at least one team made up predominantly of Cape Elizabeth youth. Other than Cape Elizabeth youth soccer and the Cape Elizabeth travel soccer, no other team activities shall be scheduled for an initial season unless first approved by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and then confirmed by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Number 10, Fort Williams Park visitors may continue to have unleashed dogs in this area when there are no scheduled events in the area. The town manager is directed to prepare for town council consideration an amendment to the dog leash rule that clarifies when dogs would need to be leashed. Number 11, the final design shall provide for the field to be visually buffered as much as is practically possible from the adjacent Delano Park neighborhood and from the central parking lot area. Number 12, the application to be submitted for site plan approval shall provide for full compliance with the Americans with Disabilities Act. Please keep those conditions in mind. They go hand in hand with the location proposal. Item number 33 is consideration of playing field funding alternatives. Based on further information from OST Associates and taking into account both construction, design, contingency amounts, the total for Lions Field is proposed to be $188,675. The total for the field at Fort Williams proposed to be $111,325. That gives a total for both fields of $300,000. It's proposed that the town be 100% responsible for any legal expenses that may occur, and that the town fund 50% or $150,000 of the total, and that private funds or in kind fund the other $150,000. It's proposed that no work on construction occur until private funds and grants are received in the amount to total $100,000. The private donation amount of the additional $50,000 may include in-kind donations that reduce the cost of the project below $300,000. Okay. If there are direct concerns about breakout of costs, we can answer those when they arise. Item number 34 is consideration to reauthorize the town to accept private funds for playing fields. In early 1995, the council unanimously authorized town staff to work with a private group to accept funds raised by that group to be placed in a town fund for the construction of the multipurpose playing fields. At this time, there is a small amount remaining in that town account. At this time, there is no group formed that has come forward to raise funds from private sources, but the council will be asked at its September meeting to authorize the town treasurer to accept funds that may be donated for the fields. And item number 35 is to consider authorization to design the playing fields, and that would be an authorization from the council to the manager to procure services for the design of the two proposed fields and to prepare an application to the planning board for site plan review with a condition that the council review the application prior to its submission. It's also noted that town council policy provides that all costs of design on municipal property be borne by the town, and it's recommended that this work would go forward prior to any private fundraising that may occur. Thank you. I would like to open the public hearing unless we have any questions from council at this point. Seeing none, it's your turn, folks. Could we have the 10-minute time frame now of the advocates, please? Would you please come to the microphone and identify yourself? Oh, I've just been reminded that we do have two representatives from OST Associates in the audience this evening. We have their boards up on display. We also have photographs of the former tenting area as it now exists for your information, and we'll have them available to answer questions. Sorry, thank you.
I'm Dan Fisher. I live at 2 Pheasant Hill Road, Cape Elizabeth, and I'm here to speak for the proponents. The first thing I'd like to do is to say thank you, Janet, because you took about 3 or 4 minutes off of what I needed to do in terms of talking about the history of what's going on. I'd also like to thank the council in terms of taking this over as a project, because the group that had been formed a year ago really didn't know which way to turn, and it came out of a meeting that Mike McGovern, Phyllis Cogswell, who was then the chairperson of the council and three or four other people from the committee that had been formed, public committee had been formed. At that point, the council basically took over the program, did the studies that Phyllis and Irv had done, and led to the proposal that's here tonight. And I want to thank the council for having done that and recognize the need that there is out there for additional field space in this town. One of the things that wasn't talked about yet is the true need for fields in this town. And I know we've talked about this in these chambers before, but I think it's important to know what's needed and why it's so important to have additional ball fields in this town. There are about 620 kids that play Little League. There should be about 100 a field per every 125 kids. If you do the math, we need four or five fields here in order to have an adequate number. Towns such as Westbrook that has 700 kids has five fields. Falmouth has 450 kids, has three fields. Scarborough is in the same position that we are in. From a Little League standpoint, they have three fields, but they are very actively pursuing and building additional field space. They also have approximately 700 kids. It becomes very apparent at the time that we play tournament ball, which is right now, in that we can't find field space in order to practice. Some of it's taken away from us by the town because there are community services activities going on now at the high school. There are other strains, and we have four or five teams that need space in order to play those, in order to practice for those games. In addition, the other major use of these fields comes from the travel soccer club that's in town. There's approximately 180 Cape kids that play soccer. They do it in the fall and a little bit in the spring. There are about 400 that participate in community services, Saturday morning soccer program. And just to kind of give you an idea of what that means, there is very little practice space on a formal field available in this town at all during the entire fall season. To kind of give you an idea of what happened last fall, approximately 75% of the games had to be scheduled out of town because there's not enough space to play home games here. We do have a very high caliber of group in the soccer association. We have represented the state with at least five teams in the last 2 years in the Eastern Regional Tournament. So it's a credit to the kids in the program that this is happening with basically a lack of facilities to be able to do it here in this town. So that's an additional need. The last thing that I really want to talk about is the fact that we were a private group that brought together a proposal which would have cost about $125,000 a year ago, a little bit more than a year ago, and that would have been the proposal at Fort Williams for both a Little League field and for a soccer multipurpose field, whatever you want to call it. When we brought that forward, that was for both usages at the fort. It did come fairly close to the Delano Park line. It also had optimum orientation for the fields, which is a north-south for a soccer field, and the facing of a south-southwest kind of an orientation for the Little League field, which is not optimum, but which is among the top two or three. The reason why I bring this up is because the proposal that's here now is really very much a compromise from what was originally planned on. That field would have cost about $125,000 to $150,000. Now we're talking about two separate fields with a price tag of $300,000. We're talking about fundraising that's more serious than what we had prior, and a lost momentum from a fundraising campaign that had been started. The last thing is that on that bit of compromise, we changed the orientation of the soccer field from the optimum north-south to a less optimum east-west, which creates glare in the morning and creates glare at night, depending on which direction you're playing ball. But it's done so that we minimize the impact on some of the neighbors, and very willing to do so. And I think that hopefully those people that are in opposed to this can see the fact that, you know, as a group, we've compromised our, from where we originally were, but because of the great need that we have, we're willing to do whatever we need to do in order to get the field space that's necessary for the kids of Cape Elizabeth. And thank you very much.
Is there anybody else, the advocates in their 10 minutes?
My name's John Chapman. I live at 77 Hillcrest Road, and I'm president of the Cape Elizabeth Little League. The Cape Elizabeth Little League supports the proposal that's before the council this evening, both in terms of the proposal for the location of the fields and, in general, the funding proposal. Let me just, in saying we support it, let me just indicate what it is that we can do. We're willing to do what we can do. If this proposal is approved, we're willing to do what we can do to help pay for it. What we can do is we can contribute money from our registration fees. We have raised our registration fees $10 per player, so that we have an additional approximately $6,000 per year that, as far as we're concerned, is dedicated to field construction. We also can contribute manpower in the fundraising effort. We did lose substantial momentum a year ago. We did have an aggressive fundraising campaign set up, and obviously that came to a screeching halt. We're willing to do what we can do to reinitiate that, keeping in mind that baseball is now out of season. The people that we have that we could rely upon to help raise money are no longer, if you will, at our disposal. But we're willing to do what we can. But I guess what I'd ask the council to do is sort of keep that $6,000 per year figure in mind, and also keep in mind that this proposal to have two fields, one for soccer, lacrosse, and field hockey, and one for baseball, presents some new fundraising challenges in the sense that the former group was a combined group when we were talking about soccer and baseball working together to raise money for a single field. We're now talking about, and as the town manager has the proposal laid out, it is delineated by soccer, or by the multipurpose field, the Fort Williams field, and the Lions field. That division raises challenges in terms of how we're going to coordinate with each other, how soccer and baseball, for example, are going to coordinate with each other. That can be done. We just need to think that through. There needs to be some formula under which money that is raised is allocated fairly between the two fields, should it get to that point. So, in closing, I just want to say that we're willing to do what we can do. I hope the council has an idea of what it is that we can do, and we're supportive of this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. There's 1 minute left in your time.
I'm Roy Dunphy. I'm the director of fields for Casco Bay Soccer. I live on 23 Columbus Road. And the proposal, although different than what we started on several years ago, is certainly a step forward and a long-standing problem. And the biggest problem I think we have as Little League is the fundraising, since the momentum is gone and that our volunteers are pretty well taxed. Soccer probably more than other sports, because we play in three seasons on several of the teams. And if it isn't to educate some of the people that some teams, it's up to the coach what they do. They all play in the fall. We ran 16 teams. In the winter, probably four or five went indoors. Another four or five played in the spring. So the volunteer hours can be pretty consuming, averaged out 75 hours of coaching in the fall, 30 coaching in the winter, and 100 to 120 in the spring. So there's a lot of volunteer hours there. That's not including transportation, meetings, and other things. So the primary concern that we have also is the fundraising. And the only thing in the proposal that is somewhat of a concern is on, is it number 9, the scheduling of the fields? Okay. It says that about the fourth sentence down is the intent that the field shall be for Cape Elizabeth youth. I was wondering if it could change something, the priority, the intent that the priority be used for Cape Elizabeth youth. Give the priority. We do have a club that we have 85% Cape youth, so we do have people from out of town. We have strict age group guidelines that you must play U12 only. So to get 16 U12 girls on one team all out of Cape Elizabeth is a difficult task. The seventh grade girls soccer team had 14 girls try out. 14 girls made it and played. But of those 14 girls, they don't all wish to play winter and spring soccer. So the numbers go down and you have to pick up a few kids from other towns. It's not that they're a huge group, but like we say, we're 85% Cape Elizabeth, but there are people from other towns that are in our club, and we wouldn't like to be exclusionary in our fundraising, because if it comes to the case on the field, as we do use SMVT, TC's field, we use Mahoney, we use other towns' fields, we have no obstacles about where your kid's from. Now, they let us use the fields in South Portland, even though we're 85% from Cape Elizabeth. So if some of these, the language could be changed a little, or as far as the predominantly Cape Elizabeth, I'm worried that exclusionary there might make difficult to fundraise, especially in the older age groups, where you'll notice in U15, 16, and 17 soccer, kids have part-time jobs and stuff like that. You will only get four girls that want to play, or five. So you've got to go dig up 10 or 12 kids from somewhere else. And, you know, so I mean, we could still do this, but I think there's a huge part of our market. Okay, there are about 15 high school kids that played spring soccer, and some went on to regionals and other teams, and they're only in groups of three or four would play other teams. They weren't affiliated with Casco Bay Soccer, I wish they were, but I could easily get a larger market to fundraise if they're not going to be excluded from using this field. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd now like to open the 10-minute time frame for those who've expressed concerns and have questions. Who would like to start?
My name is Marion Guthrie, and I'm an abutter, but I don't have to introduce myself. I'm sure that most people know me. I want to thank you for including the abutters in the process. It's very nice to be included this year, and we really appreciate it. But I would also like to tell the public and the council that the issue of developing fields at Fort Williams Park goes beyond my little neighborhood. And I just wanted to remind you that it is a town-wide, probably very controversial, critical land use issue. It goes beyond my neighborhood. Secondly, I think that it was a wonderful compromise to locate the fields in different places. I appreciate not having a soccer field at my front door. And, you know, I just wanted to say to the committee, thank you for moving the field, but you're not moving it just for my neighborhood. You're moving it to help the people who have used that area for many, many years to have a little space left to continue to use it. And when it's buffered, it's not just being buffered for my neighborhood, it's being buffered so that the people who have used that area in a passive way can continue to use it. So that's all I'll say right now. I'm here to listen, and I will maybe speak later on in the evening, but right now I would like to introduce you to Richard Berman of Shore Road, who will speak for a group of us. Thank you.
Where I can put this so that the council and the public can see it. Does that work here?
Okay.
Could you have one of your compatriots hold that for you, perhaps?
What I could do is put it here so you can see it and then turn it around for the public.
Okay.
My name is Richard Berman, and I live on Shore Road. And I'm not here as a proponent or opponent. I really am here representing community, community through compromise, and community through consensus building. What has happened is a group of people, probably about 30 people, that I would say are very concerned about Fort Williams Park and the usage, that have gotten together and have said, look, is there a way, is there a compromise, is there a way that we can include fields and yet advance the real need, the very real need, for passive recreation? And, you know, we've heard about the need for fields, and we admit absolutely that there's a need. But I might also remind you in your comprehensive plan that the population growth in Cape Elizabeth, the 50 to 54-year-old group, is going to grow over the next 10 years by 136%. The 10 to 14-year-olds will grow by 2%. There's a very real need in Cape Elizabeth for passive recreation. And with that in mind, we were wondering if we couldn't reach some sort of compromise and build consensus around something that would not only look at the needs for fields, but also the very real needs for passive recreation, and how could we advance that in a compromise situation. We had a series of meetings. We met with Mr. Dunphy, who you just heard before, who represents soccer. Mr. Chapman was contacted on the phone, and I think we're heading towards a consensus here. And I think the council will be very interested to see how well this parallels, I think, what you're thinking about now. And we would support that. I would like to take a few minutes just to go over the plans and see how similar they are. Generally speaking, again, the idea was to include a field, limit the use of that field by separating the fields. That was very, very important to all the people, to separate the ball field from the multi-use field. And so the idea of having the Little League field and Lions field and having the multi-purpose field here restricted to soccer, lacrosse, field hockey, and general play made a whole lot of sense, and we got buy-ins from all the stakeholders. We have shown this. This is somewhat a little different than that orientation, but it basically shows that soccer, lacrosse, field hockey, general play field in an east-west orientation. It's put this. You know, this is the border of the park in Delano Park. This is what's called Blake Road. And here's the maintenance building. So this is very similar to, I think it's alternative 5 or alternative 4 that Mr. Yost came up with. So it has the soccer field east-west. It does not take away Blake Road because we don't have the baseball overlapping it. Again, that was central. The quid pro quid was, okay, let's separate those fields, have a field here, but then really get all buy-ins to really protect the rest of the land around it to make it forever wild, or passive recreation, or open space. So that's kind of what we're looking for in this consensus, this compromise. So far we think we're heading in the right direction, and we're getting everybody to talk about this. Part of that would be preserving, you know, buffering both sides. We're not sure if this is a landscape buffer or a fence that protects it from the parking lot so that the general public isn't invited in. Definitely a naturalistic buffer here. But generally speaking, again, it's like separate the fields, have an east-west orientation, have the Lions field be the softball field, and then take the tenting area, the battery area, the green, the rest of this area, and also what's called a Southwest Reserve, and keep that, commit to keeping that into passive open space, passive recreation and open space to serve the needs of the,
I hate to use this word, the silent majority of this town, the older people who aren't organized, that don't come before this council and beg for open space. It's very necessary. So that was a general concept. What we did is we came up with a list of conditions. And you can see some of those are marked out. It shows that consensus process. It shows that we've been meeting. And some of the things that we wanted, Mr. Dunphy couldn't buy into. And so we've gone back and forth and tried to come up with something that builds consensus. I'll quickly read those to you. By the way, everything that we're proposing sounds very similar to where the council is heading. And I might add that it's consistent with the master plan that was put together for the Fort Williams. I think it's great that we've been working separately from the council, trying to reach this compromise, reach this consensus, get this community back speaking with each other instead of the divisiveness we've felt over the last few years. Some of the details, we said that, I mentioned this before, A was the field to be used for soccer, lacrosse, field hockey, and general play only. The field to have no permanent improvements, and that's consistent with your recommendations, such as scoreboards, bleachers, concession stands, advertising, goalposts, creases, fencing, etc. Sound amplification and artificial lighting shall be prohibitive. Again, that's consistent with what I'm reading in your conditions. There shall be no expansion of parking areas or vehicular access along Blake, Merriman, or Harrison Road as part of the field's usage. We understand that that's used for special events and everything. Again, that's consistent with your recommendations. The asphalt storage area shall be converted to permanent open space passive recreation area by the removal of the stockpiled material and revegetating of that area. This is in the Southwest Reserve. Right now, that's being used as a dump. And that's why this place looks like a dump, because it's being used as a dump. And we read in Mr. Yost's report that that is a temporary thing, that the town is intending to move that. What we're saying is, as part of the construction of the fields, if we're giving up this type of passive recreation for active, let's get this area back. It's part of a trail system. There's a beautiful stone wall right now that's being destroyed. And Fort Williams is such a gem of a park. We should all be very proud of it, and we shouldn't be using it as a dump. There's got to be a better place for that asphalt. So as part of the construction, we would like to see that area reclaimed for passive recreation. F was the remaining areas, as I mentioned, known as the Southwest Reserve, the tenting area, the battery areas, and the green, shall be permanently dedicated to open space and passive recreation. This is a very important part of building this consensus. We want to avoid an elongated fight, referendum, lawsuits, everything else. We want to reach consensus. Part of that is really keeping the rest of this for passive recreation and open space. It's really needed. The G, the current unleashed dog policy, shall remain. I think that's consistent with what you're saying. I can understand the need for, when there's at scheduled play, there might be some movement on that. We also had fields to be used by Cape Elizabeth residents primarily, or with a priority. As Mr. Dunphy was saying, that language needs to be, we understand his needs, so we understand that. Again, I noticed in your writings, we had the material storage area south of the field shall be relocated. And again, I guess that was part of the original recommendations, that the concrete area where the maintenance has some stockpiled area, again, that's a poor use of that area. That should be closer to the maintenance building. And that area should be revegetated. And again, I saw that was consistent with some recommendations that you had. We also had some design recommendations, and I suppose these would be part of the planning board review process. But just to go over them, the field have an east-west orientation. The field should be graded. We recommend that the field be graded as per the original proposal that the Cape Elizabeth Fields Committee put forth before. They were a lot more sensitive in their grading plan than the ideal that the engineering firm has in their proposal. We'd like them to look at that. The reason is, if you grade across this field, as was originally proposed by the field committees, you're a lot more sensitive. You need a lot less fill. It'll be a lot less expensive also, and it will preserve this wooded area that has been called in the master plan to be a naturalized successional wood growth. And if you if you grade it the way it's recommended, you'll lose half those trees. So we think there's an easier way to grade it that might not be ideal, but again, we're looking for that compromise. And we have consensus. We have talked about that. The landscape buffer shall be placed along the north and south sides of the field, again, consistent with where I think you're going. The pedestrian path towards the green shall be retained and or relocated. This is a major path that people use across this field now. We just need some clearing in here to extend that, to keep that path intact. This is the path that goes down these steps, beautiful steps towards the green and around to the lighthouse. We can see how easy that is to extend into this asphalt dump area when that is reclaimed. And then finally, all stone walls shall be preserved. The stone walls represent the history of the park. If you had to build them now, it would cost you $200 a linear foot, and they're really an asset, and we'd like to see those retained. I would make some just some clarifications as I was reading, reading this, and I just make this not as argumentative, but just as clarification. And here it says the area of the park which the field should be located is not now in proof of park or recreational use. This is well used. It doesn't look passive recreation. You wouldn't look at it and say, "Oh, that's designed for passive recreation." It's just used that way. Right now, you've put a dog toilet down there. It's the greatest thing possible. My dog doesn't go except in my yard. I always pick up a plastic bag. I pick up trash. I pick up other dog poop. So you're heading in the right direction. I just want to let you know that this is very much a used area right now. And even though it doesn't look designed that way, it is used. So in conclusion, I just say that we feel very strongly that we want to bring our community back together to try to build consensus so that we can be once more a community instead of feeling this terrible feeling we've had over the last few years about this fight. We think we're heading in the right direction. I don't speak for the whole town, obviously. There's people who come up and say, we don't want anything there. I don't want anything there, yet I think that the healing that this town has to go through is more important. And if we can preserve the rest, it's open in natural areas, if we can reclaim some areas, I think we have a compromise where we all come out as winners, where the town will feel really good about itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is that something we can keep
you got
for a
copies
while?
Of that, or small copies? Can you get
we can leave this copy.
Mr. Berman, would you put it over with the boards over there, please?
Nothing to do with
I think over there. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I took a little
bit. We're aware of what the timing has been. Mr. Berman, do you happen to have written copies of the conditions that you read this evening?
I can get those. There's a copy right on the board itself.
Okay.
And I can get you clean copies.
If you could get those to the manager's office sometime this week, please, in the next couple of days. Thank you. All right, that concludes the opening 10 minutes or 10 minutes plus for each group. Is there anybody who would like to speak as an advocate for a moment? Please come to the microphone, give us your name and address.
Good evening. My name is Michael Roy. I live at 51 Hillcrest Road. I'm the Director of Fields for Cape Little League, and I am here to speak in favor of the proposal before you. I would first like to congratulate Mr. Berman and his group for coming here tonight in a real spirit of consensus. I think from the get-go, this has always been about sharing. About sharing a resource, about a community acting like a community and trying to share something that's obviously very precious and very valuable to all of us. And I think that What has made this issue particularly contentious is the location. It is such a precious location. And I think the question has always been, why there? Well, if you think about why there, I think most of us in the room are familiar with the reasons why there. If you've tried to build in Cape Elizabeth, if you've tried to develop land in Cape Elizabeth, if you've tried to plant a tree in Cape Elizabeth, you know some inescapable facts. Cape Elizabeth is basically wet and ledgy, not very flat. The conditions you need to build a ball field are that you have fairly dry, well-drained land that is not particularly ledgy, not expensive to develop, and current economic conditions understood that is hopefully land already owned by the town. To go out and purchase such land would be very difficult. So that limits our choices dramatically as far as where we can put ball fields. The land required for passive recreation doesn't necessarily have those kinds of restraints. You don't necessarily have to have dry, flat land, although it should be somewhat dry. And I think that some sort of shared use of this segment of the park makes a lot of sense. I would take it one step further. I would say the town of Cape Elizabeth should look very hard and seriously at its overall land usage, as you are planning to do, and develop as part of your master recreation plan a more focused approach to passive recreation. I must admit that I'm all too quickly coming into that 50 to 54 demographic where I may be out walking my dog or whatever, and I actually already do use the green belt somewhat, but I think the green belt really needs to be looked at very hard and developed as a site for passive recreation. It is much more amenable to that as opposed to a ball field. I'd just like to close with a few questions for Mr. McGovern or whomever wishes to answer them. One is, the proposal doesn't refer to a zoning board referral for the wetland setback changes that would be required for the Lions Field part of the proposal. And I wonder what would be the timetable for that and the process for that. The other question I have is, will private and or federal grants and any in-kind donations be applied to the private share of the expenses, or would they be part of, that would be under the private? Okay, fine, just wanted to know, because as Mr. Chapman and Mr. Dunphy have alluded to, this proposal, its overall cost is somewhat more expensive, and the fundraising will be a challenge. Thank you for your attention.
I want to quickly answer those questions. I give you a very quick nod. It was the understanding of the council at its workshop on the June 24th that grants, either from private foundations or from public entities, would be put on the side of the private contributions. As your question about the timing on the wetland setback, would this have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals? What we are looking at, rather than that, is to have the Council's Ordinance Committee draft language considering lessening the linear footage of the setback from 250 feet to 100 feet. Councilor Jordan is chairman of that committee. I believe they have a meeting coming up later this month to start work on that. So it would be, we'd be looking at an ordinance text amendment rather than going to the Board of Appeals. Okay, thank you. Who would like to be next speaking? Somebody who has some concerns?
Bill Dodd, Consensus.
I'm just nicely dumbfounded. I mean, consensus and compromise are two of my favorite words. Yes, ma'am, please come to the mic. Please, you do have to come to the microphone, give us your name and address. That's where our sound system is.
I'm Emily Madison. I live at 2 Charles Road, and I'm opposed to any fields in the fort. So I don't know how it can be a compromise.
Do you have any other specific recommendations for us?
No. I don't have any little leaguers, and I'm not really familiar with that, but I enjoy the fort as it is, and I think it's a shame to take away the one last remaining part of the fort that's sort of natural and pleasant to be in, where you're away from fields and children. I walk my dog there often. And I think it's just too bad that there's so much opposition to this, that how it can be considered a compromise. You can't compromise a no.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to speak?
My name is Elizabeth Carroll, and I live at 23 Meadow Way. I have a question for Mike, or I guess anybody. I thought he might know. I think the fort is made up of 90 acres, did you say? And just what, how many acres are we looking at in this passive part now? In this area of passive recreation that we're considering, how much of the fort is given to this area of passive recreation right now?
The good percentage of it, the entry field for passive recreational
No, just the area that you're looking at it developing.
How many acres are in this site? It's a little over 3 acres in this general area.
It's three acres that is just left undeveloped.
I'm not sure we're understanding your question, ma'am.
The area that's being considered, which people are looking at, just as Emily addressed a couple of minutes ago, is the one area in the park which people use that's undeveloped. It doesn't have a parade ground. It doesn't have an area where people are playing ball. It doesn't have an area where there is a playground or swings or people going to the beach. This is the one area where people walk undisturbed and don't have to watch a field or a frisbee. And I'm wondering how much of the 90 acres is left for that. That's 3 acres?
No.
We looked at it last year, and I didn't bring all the numbers with me, but it all depends on how you define passive and, you know, how you define open space. There's the, under the, when the town accepted the current Fort Williams policy back in 1976, it permanently dedicated as open space for passive use only. That whole section of the fort along the ocean from inside, I don't know all the road names, but all along the whole ocean section, which is, you know, roughly about a sixth of the fort. In addition, set aside for passive use only, but some of it is more active, is most of the parade ground, the field that's above the parade ground up near the fire station, as well as most of that, what we call the entry field going in. And, you know, even today, you know, yesterday I saw, you know, one guy there with a five-year-old, or even, I think it was even younger than that, with a bat, you know, just three people, and, you know, it's that type of activity, and we have had some more extensive activity, and our rangers have been on top of it, too.
Okay, maybe I should redefine then.
Yeah, I'm not
sure. I'm wondering how much of the fort is left after you take away that which is developed fields for just natural growth. And that would be the area that I'm talking of right now that we're considering. And you're saying that's three acres.
But there's still other areas of the park that are still left as open. The whole Chapel Road area is that, you know, as you on the far other side of the park, the quadrant that, you know, up beyond the
up towards the mansion.
The recycle, yeah, up near the mansion.
That which doesn't offer the
that whole front corner.
Right.
We are up beyond where the materials are being recycled that do look dumpy.
Okay. But this area, which is just in its natural state now, is only 3 acres out of the 90? No, Phyllis, you're saying.
I believe the project, as it was originally proposed, took about 3 acres.
Okay, that's what correct. The project is 3, but the whole area there is about what?
27, wasn't it?
No,
it's not that large.
No.
It could easily be that.
Let us get that information for you. I think
okay.
We're spinning our wheels right now.
Thanks. Can you get it, Phyllis?
We will get that for you
through
the manager's office.
We have engineers that figure those things out better than we do.
Is there anybody else who'd like to speak? Yes, ma'am, and then the gentleman in the back. Oh, you're, come right up.
My name is Barbara Durgan, and I live on Starboard Drive. I really am interested in everything everybody has said today, because I'm still living back in June 1995, when we had that last meeting, and so many people were here, and everybody was discussing openly how they felt about the park. And I still remember one lady there that was talking about, she came from South Portland, and she was talking about how meaningful the park was for her and her children, and how it has such an openness for the general community in large, you know. And my sentiments were mostly historical, as far as the park was concerned, that I liked the history attached to the park, the way it is now, and all the pleasant things that go on in the park right now. One of my favorite things is the kite washing, which I enjoyed during, well, quite often I enjoy that. But in any case, and besides, I like everybody. I haven't been mad at a soul over this thing. But if I could dream, and I guess everybody's allowed to do a little bit of that, I would like to see Cape Elizabeth look at the park as a gem, which we all do. But you all have worked so hard on different plans and different areas for this and for that. And I'm just so afraid that in time, once you open up that door and you start to specify this area for that and that area for this, and take away the general beauty and the general openness and the general feel of history that the park has for everybody, not just for the people in Cape Elizabeth or South Portland, but people that come from all directions.
Yeah, I think if you back away from that a little bit, it might...
Yeah, I'm wondering, is that better?
Yes. Thank you.
Why am I doing that?
I think it's very sensitive tonight.
Okay. So I just think that that would open up a door in the future that bit by bit the feel of the park would be chipped away. Now that's not very important to everybody now, because you're all thinking about your plans and your money and how and the circumstances of the earth and the ledge and all that stuff. But this obviously is terribly important because it's going on for so many years. And I mean, that's pretty evident. But I wouldn't, if this were a perfect world, I would just say, please just be careful and really don't change the park. Now, after I said that, I would like to say that I really love children, and I would love to see them have all the proper kinds of playing fields that they really should have in this town. I mean, this is pretty ridiculous. We don't have a beautiful area for our children to have the proper fields in. And if we're going to do that, I know it's a lot of money, but you know, sometimes you can say, so it's only money, because the issue is so important. I mean, these are our youngsters, and they should have a freedom of athletic opportunities, and they should be able to go, not have to be hampered by having to play at this place at that time and go to this place or whatever they do now. They've got a lot of work in their hands here, I guess, because I've been just I've been trying to absorb everything tonight. I mean, I haven't done any work, obviously, on this thing. But it seems to me, if you're going to spend all this money, that you better start thinking now of a real park, sports park or athletic park or something for the children, and give them something that's really good and that will last and we can be proud of. So let's spend more dollars. And I know it's hard to come by money. It's not easy to do, but if you're going to do it right. I mean, doing this piecemeal thing and attacking the park that in itself is so precious. I mean, it is precious. This is how I feel about it. And as I said, if dreams could be realized, this is what I would want. And I'd want the children of Cape Elizabeth to have and to have their children have it. And I just can't see why a town, even if it takes a longer time, a town like this couldn't give their children the best kind of a feel in a place that's easy to get to, with the proper kind of room for their activities, where they can invite outsiders in, and where we can open up, you know, good relationships with our surrounding town in that. And I just feel that, I know it's money, and I know you have these concerns, and I know there's been all kinds of things going on in different places about this, but I still feel it's minuscule to the problems, to have some vision on this, and I feel that you really should look upon it in that light. I'm doing it again, I apologize.
Your time is about up, Paul.
Well, I'm so sorry, and so I'll stop. So that's my idea, thank you.
Thank you very much. Gentleman towards the back, on the blue shirt. I gotta give shirt colors now.
My name is Edward Matterson, and I live at 2 Charles Road, Cape Elizabeth. And I've been here for 30 years. I did the sculpture of Joan Benoit. So I work on the library. And I'd just like to say that I think that the fort should be left the way it is. I think it's been developed and overdeveloped already to the point of approaching sort of a Disneyland aspect. And I don't understand why this meeting wasn't more publicized than it has been. We just found out about it almost inadvertently today. I didn't hear all of my friend Richard Berman's proposal, which sounds reasonable, and I certainly admire his talk. But my feeling is that we do need that original sense of history. I don't think you can prettify the main coast. I mean, where does it end? Do you start plastering the rocks on the beach with cement or what? Some of the other things I thought about was in quickly reading the article, thing about examining the other areas that they're all dismissed very rapidly. I don't know why. I don't know how this came back to being the fort when it seemed like about 50% of the townspeople were very much opposed to it the last meeting. I think there's a lot of questions that have to be answered. And I think that the history of the fort, the idea of the Second World War, the ruin, even the ruin of it, has an appeal which should not be lost. And the whole total organization of this whole Little League approach to me is frightening, because it is too highly organized. And there has to be something said for individual appreciation of things rather than as a group. An organization. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Before you start, sir, if I could ask the audience to refrain from clapping in the future. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Mark Millar. I live on 23 Fowler Road and here in Cape Elizabeth. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for about 16 years. And I really want to commend the council for their work on this compromise. I'm director of softball, but I'm also a member of the Appalachian Mountain Club. I spend hours walking in the woods, and I have a deep appreciation for open space. One of the issues they were talking about this evening, which is that the field that's proposed is not mutually exclusive, that it can be used during the day for people to walk their dogs, to reflect, and it can be used also in the evening or in the mornings for a soccer field, a lacrosse field. For those who've gone up there, and I've gone up there many times, there is a field there now. There's grassy, open space there now. What's being proposed is not a radical rape of the open space that's left in that park. I wouldn't support that. What's being proposed is to have a flat playing field, have some drainage put in, and have ample space for lacrosse, for soccer. We had wished there'd been a Little League field there, but we're willing to go along with that compromise. So I think it's important for people really to be able to look at that and to take a walk up there and take a look at the land and property up there. We're not proposing something radical there. And thank you very much for your consideration, and thank you very much for your presentation. I really enjoyed that and the consensus that was built, and that's what we're here to try to work towards. Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to be next? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Carol Haas. I live at Six Loxley Road. I think it's important to realize that putting an organized field in what we have always considered the passive recreation section of Fort Williams is asking many town residents to give up an important part of their daily and weekly lives. What we value is the quiet and seclusion of this area compared with the rest of the park. I feel that any opposition to further athletic field development in the park has consistently and really quite incorrectly been categorized as coming from the abutters to the area, when in fact it is primarily coming from the many taxpaying citizens who are users, not abutters of the park. I have been a part of and will personally support the consensus plan that we've been working on for the past week or so, because it does develop a consensus among the current users, the abutters, and the athletic interests. My own personal concerns are that the existing field, and there is a good size existing field there, and my vision is that that field would be expanded only as much as is necessary to make it adequate for play and for safety. I also feel very strongly that a vegetative buffer has to be retained that can hide the field from the parking lot and from the roads, particularly as people come down over the hill by the flagpole, because I really don't want the park's million visitors to be encouraged to come into this area. It's important to those of us that use it that it remain as secluded as possible and that it remain as quiet as possible. And it's not to say that we don't want people playing there, it's just that we don't want a million people throwing frisbees and having barbecues and having a nice time there. I also think that it's important that the necessary changes be carried out absolutely in the most minimal way possible to have the minimal impact on the area. I have felt that the users of this part of this park haven't been given that much consideration because the attention has been elsewhere. I personally will object to any alteration in the park's use unless the many concerns expressed by the users aren't respected. And I believe that the consensus plan really is the way to go at this point. I think really most of us do not want to have a protracted fight over ball fields anymore. We don't want to delay the project particularly. We don't want to impede the fundraising, and another big fight's going to impede the fundraising. And we certainly don't want to cause any further divisiveness in the town. And that's why, although I personally don't want to see any additional fields or development in that part of the park, I'm willing to support the consensus agreement that's being developed among the citizens with respect for all concerned.
Thank you. Who would like to be next? Yes, ma'am.
Ruth Pitsley from Old Fort Road. Forgive me if I muddy the waters a little bit. I have a couple of thoughts on things that have been said. A park is a park is a park, and a ballpark is something else and something different. And the difference isn't too subtle. And once something is established, it never vanishes, disappears. It is enlarged upon and embellished. And the noise from a baseball field will attract people. Trees won't stop them from seeking out the area. Life used to be so simple. When I played baseball, whoever owned the ball made the rules, and it was a pickup game, and the bases wherever you put a rock down. There wasn't much stress to playing baseball. There was no organization, and it was great fun. And I dare say a lot of the young folks who are in Little League are perhaps not all that happy with the stresses and sitting on the bench, perhaps. A lot of them sit on the bench a great deal of the time. The first gentleman who came up here to speak, I noticed on the bottom of his shorts he had a basketball. And why in Cape Elizabeth can't we increase the numbers of sports that are available for young folks during the summertime? Swimming, baseball, basketball, Tiddlywinks tournament. They had that at Harvard, I remember. But anyway, that would siphon off some of the leaguers and perhaps take the need for more and more and more fields down a bit. I think if we tried hard enough, we could find the money and the means for putting ball fields in, baseball fields in the Lions Field, and that area across from the dump. The field is beautiful. It's clear, it's fairly flat, it's open, there are no neighbors to disturb, and if a grand, wonderful, all-purpose field were put in there, off-season, the goals could be taken up and there would be no evidence of anyone having been there. I think that would eliminate the need for putting fields in the fort at all. And that is, the demographics are going to make the, or are going to indicate that a need for a quiet spot is increasingly necessary and increasingly harder to find. So I hope that you might find some way to preserve that area in the park and keep the park a park. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Ken Johnson. I live on 12 Orchid Road. I've been a resident for 16 years. I have three children who play baseball and soccer. I was also fortunate enough to be a coach this year of an eight-year-old team that we played up on the newer field in Fort Williams near Officers Row. And a couple things, because this was sort of after the vote of no field there, as I was taking up my position as first base coach every game. I noticed a couple things. There were walkers continuously coming around our field and on the path. Many of them had dogs. Most of them stopped. A lot of them laughed, like most of the parents were laughing at our eight-year-olds. The point I want to make is that these two activities, baseball and walking and dogs, are not mutually exclusive in that park. It wasn't as quiet as if there were no kids there. But it seemed like both groups survived. And I think that's a point that I'm not sure has been said here. The next thing I'm a little reluctant to say, because I'm very, very pleased with both the council's recommendation and all the recommendations I hear here about the fields, because it looks like it's a good chance we're going to get fields fairly quickly. Question is where. The question I have, and I'm also actively involved in the fundraising for both soccer and baseball, is that I have no problem with the town picking up the $150,000 for the fields. I'm glad to pay my family's portion of that. It'd be a lot easier for me to do that than to raise extra money. On the other hand, I've also coached five T-ball teams the last 3 years. If we're designing this field over the multi-purpose field, and there's not a baseball field there, if the group is thinking that no one's going to be on that field from April to August, I don't think that's a real accurate assessment. You can't find fields around here. I've never scheduled or called the town hall to schedule a T-ball practice field. You go to where the levelest spot is, and that's the open, most open spot. Are there going to be people up there? And the question I would ask the council, and you hate to bring up the muddy water, but if we're doing this proposal and spending an extra $150,000 just for the hope of not having anyone up in that area from April to September, I think that might be a poor use of the town's money. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Before we go on, let me just remind people, if you want to come up and just say that you're here as an advocate, you're here and share the concerns that have already been expressed and you subscribe to the points already made, that's certainly something you can do as well. I'm sensing a bit of hesitancy. That may just be a misread on my part, but I want people to feel comfortable doing that. Who else would like to come to the microphone? Thank you.
I'm Carol Fritz. I know you're well aware that I have opposed fields at Fort Williams, additional fields there, and I've never opposed Little League fields at Lions Field. But it has been clear at the last meetings of the council that you will be voting for a field at Fort Williams, at least one. So in order to avoid divisions in the town that have been mentioned, I have been part of the compromise group. And I urge you to add to your conditions the items that were listed by Mr. Berman. If we have to have a field in that southern area of the fort, let's do the best we can to avoid problems and conflict. I think that if we do not impose a Little League field on top of a soccer field there, it will avoid a lot of scheduling problems. And I do think the council has a responsibility, as stated in the ordinances under for Fort Williams in 19-2-7, that it be compatible with a budding residential zone. So that I hope that you'll maybe change the title of this field to, instead of a multi-purpose field, that it be a soccer lacrosse field, so that it's much more descriptive for future councils, for the Fort Williams Committee, to know hopefully what you intend. And I'm particularly interested in there being a substantial buffer between the parking lot, as has been mentioned, and the neighborhood, preserving the historic walls of the fort, allowing dogs to run loose, and please clean up the asphalt debris. I know I like to recycle asphalt as well, but to have the dump at Fort Williams is just unconscionable. And particularly committing the town now to the remaining area being for passive recreation. Over the years, in my efforts to protect Fort Williams, I've talked to several historians who have all sadly remarked about how Cape Elizabeth has allowed the historic features of the fort to deteriorate over the years, so that there's almost nothing left that's historical. It's really very sad what the town has allowed to happen at Fort Williams, and it's continuing with the Garish Battery. I hope you'll do the responsible thing right now.
Thank you. Who would like to be next? We have a gentleman and then you, ma'am.
Madam Chair.
Yes, ma'am.
Would it be possible to save time, since there are many people who may or may not even want to speak, but at least for the council to know the number of speakers who want to speak, if they could possibly line up so that we could save the time for having to choose who or whatever? Is that something we could please consider?
We could ask those who wish to speak to form a line over there. Thank you. Yes, sir?
What's a short line? Steve Goldstein, Highview Road. I am a proponent of the field and would like to see fields put in wherever the town council can squeeze them into this town, and I'm happy to pay my taxes towards that. I just want to address just a couple of misconceptions brought up over and over and over again by some of the opponents to the field, in particular to the lady in the green dress. I'm sorry, I didn't catch her name. First of all, you have to understand that they're not building a baseball field at Fort Williams. This is a multi-purpose field for long ball sports such as soccer, lacrosse. The baseball field will be built at Lions Field. Secondly, there are infinite sports currently available, and I didn't even want to make a list because it would go on so long, from sports you've never even heard of. For instance, this spring, my son was involved right up into the middle of April. He was on a ski team. He was on Roy Dunphy's soccer league, which was Sundays, and he was on Little League Baseball. And he was mad at me because he couldn't play basketball, which was going on at the same time. So there are really infinite sports. Another problem with the growth of sports and why we need more fields is because there are even more sports coming out on an organized fashion. For instance, lacrosse is becoming a highly organized sport that happens to be the same season as baseball. And I understand that, and my children are in elementary school, but I understand that there's some teams that have been formed in the middle school and they're looking for space. Also, there's an increasingly number of young women that are getting involved in organized sports, far more than in the past, particularly in soccer, lacrosse. I guess the high school now has a women's lacrosse team that's new. And just as an example, I had practice for my Little League team every Friday from 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock, and we had to work our way around the high school trying to find a field that wasn't used because there was so many sports going on between the lacrosse, baseball, softball, and track and field events. And that's pretty much it.
Thank you very much.
I'm Ann Van Lonkhuizen, Shore Road. I'm opposed to putting any fields in the fort. I think that there will not be enough quiet space around. All you'll have is a little periphery where you can walk, and it'll be noisy, and you just won't have any room. And instead of having all these restrictions, if according to this, what this man just said, that there are so many people who now want all these sports, I think you should plan ahead for a decent complex someplace else, not in Fort Williams. Thank you.
Thank you.
Betty Crane. I live on Waven Road in Shore Acres. First, I'd like to thank Mr. Berman, and I am, for compromise, and all the people that worked on that proposal, threw in their ideas and so forth. But I have one question. On the last page of Mr. McGovern's memo, or whatever, where it talks about the Fort Williams Advisory Commission meeting of June 1st, 1995, mm-hmm. and the vote being 3-3. Mm-hmm. Have I missed something? Has something occurred since then? Does this really constitute the Fort Williams Advisory Committee recommending that they go for a field in the fort?
Okay, this, as you pointed out, was 1995. Mm-hmm. This is not the proposal that's currently being considered at this time. This was the proposal that was put forward by a private group more than a mm-hmm. year ago. So what is being considered this evening, there's also a proposal to send this back to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and to the Planning Board for their comments on what is being currently proposed. At that time, they were looking at two fields at Fort Williams. Mm-hmm. Tonight, we are looking at one field at Fort Williams.
So my understanding is that the Fort Williams Advisory Committee has not yet recommended or accepted the plan that you're going to send to them.
They have made recommendations on something that had some similarities, but not on the specific plan that we are considering this evening.
And what was the vote on that? The breakdown on the committee. On the Fort Williams Advisory Committee.
On the original proposal, they voted 3-3.
Yeah.
On something similar to this proposal and similar to the consensus, they voted 5-1 in favor.
Mm-hmm. In favor.
In favor. Okay. But this was, again, a year ago, and it was not, that still had a Little League mm-hmm. component to it.
Well, May, thank you for clarifying this, and I imagine a few other people. Thank you. I would just like to say that I am willing to compromise, but I have been opposed to having any formal fields in the fort. And for the reasons that we've done a wonderful job with the fort, I think it's retained some of its character. We haven't spent an awful lot of money. A lot of people in the past worked very hard to preserve it and to make it a recreation, passive recreation, or something not formalized. And I think this is what a lot of people in town like about the fort. And I would ask the council to think in terms of not right now, but 20 years from now, when these little league kids are having families, they may thank us that they still have open space in the fort that isn't utilized for anything but passive walking. Less and less of this type of area is available in the state of Maine. I don't know how many of you are from the state of Maine, but if you've lived in other parts of the country, you know that the coastline is not available. We are so fortunate to have this. And I would ask you to think about this, think the future, not just today. But I am for compromise. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir?
My name's John Brady from Spoondrift Lane, and I think my T-shirt says it all, how I feel. The T-shirt was given to me by my 12-year-old boys' soccer team shortly after I was... They were afraid I was going to be arrested down at the park one day when we were down there having passive recreation. we've won our the state championship 3 years in a row and had an opportunity to compete postseason and couldn't find any fields to play. So we took a chance and went down kind of unofficially and got involved in some recreation just for about an hour because we needed to do something. But I think... the consensus here this evening with the compromise, and the shirt says life is good, and I think the fact that there's a soccer ball player or a soccer player here doesn't mean that it's confined just to soccer people. The fact that the town can get back together again with a common consensus is terrific. And that's what I had to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who wants to get in line? Yes, sir.
My name's Tim Thompson. I live on Pine Ridge Road. I was so stunned with John's good delivery, I was sitting there watching him. Forgot I was supposed to get in line. I'm very happy to see that the town has been able to get a compromise put together that seems to satisfy the town's needs as well as the children's needs. I think it's an affordable program. It's certainly, if you look at where we're at right now from the availability of fields, we are very fortunate in that we have resources that we've been able to find. But as I coach teams, and I visit other towns, it really is kind of amazing the fields that these other towns that are very comparable to our town, the fields that they have. We really are way, way behind many of our budding neighbors when it comes to the recreational space that's available, whether it's soccer or lacrosse fields or multipurpose fields. Or just baseball fields. We just don't have, for our participant size, the number of kids involved, we don't have fields. In preparing a soccer team to go to a regional tournament in Niagara Falls, there were no fields available. The fields that we have over at the school are so overused, we had to plow them all up and reseed them and refertilize them, because frankly, we overused them. I had a game scheduled at one of the fields that had to be changed at the very last minute because we were in the process of refertilizing and reseeding those fields. So the resources that we have are getting overused. that can't be an inexpensive process for us to have to go reseed and refertilize and re-prepare those lacrosse and soccer fields because of overuse. The one thing I would like to ask, in the proposal, it sounds like this can't go forward until $100,000 is raised. I was just wondering if there was, or I'd like to ask that maybe some consideration be made that some of the in-kind donations and some of the preparation on the fields might be able to begin before that $100,000 mark is hit. That's going to put us farther down the road as far as when we could begin this field preparation. But I am very definitely a proponent to this consensus. I know if there was an easier solution, we would have probably found it several years ago. But I know the time and the effort that the council has put in to trying to come up with a better idea. And I just think that this is the best one, and I'd like to see us move forward post-haste. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I'm last.
We'll see.
My name's Karen Dunphy. I live at 23 Columbus Road. I've coached community services soccer, softball, and I have three kids who play soccer, and softball, and a six-year-old who informs me she's going to play field hockey. So I'm really familiar with the lack of field space in the town. I drive all over the place trying to find one with my kids. So I am for the field in Fort Williams. I wish we were going to get a multi-purpose field in Fort Williams and Lions Field, but it's not going to happen. I would urge the council to move forward with this as soon as possible and find ways to do that rather than obstacles for the same. And echo Tim with the, we have a lot of manpower volunteer-wise between soccer and Little League, and we can do a lot of work if you will let us begin, not just fundraising for field prep. And if we can start doing that to get the ball rolling for these fields, it will help our fundraising efforts if we can get some momentum going again. Thanks.
Thank you. We're on our second round of speakers. And I would ask that people coming to the microphone for a second time would give us new information, please.
You doubted that I'd give you new information?
I just want to avoid redundancy.
Well, I'll be redundant and say my name is Marion Guthrie, 8 Delano Park. The results of the recent town election have been hailed by some as a victory for vision and progressive ideas in our town. Personally, I believe that progress and vision also require a large component of wisdom, and that is the wisdom to know when to stop, when to preserve the character of unique things and places like Fort Williams Park. If the current council elects to go forward after this in September, after the Fort Williams Park Commission, and we all go to those meetings again, and if this precious parcel that I can assure you I am very sad to see it go is developed in the park, please at that time use your power, your vision, and most importantly, your wisdom at that time, and say, at last, now is the time to stop at Fort Williams Park. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any more new information?
Michael Roy, 51 Hillcrest Road. I basically wanted to underscore something Karen Dunphy mentioned earlier, and that is the need to move forward. I think it should be pointed out in fairness that if the town council goes through the process as outlined in the proposal and votes on this in September, that will give private groups basically the fall and winter to raise necessary funding and come up with the plans we need to do so. The construction on the fields would then optimally start in the spring. The fields, in turn, must be rested at least until the spring of 1998. So I think that needs to be pointed out, that any delays need to, you need to tack on that necessary rest time after the field is actually constructed to allow it the seeding to take and for the project to be a truly long-lasting one. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I just have a question. Somebody brought this up and it made me wonder. Now, the people that are with this consensus, the word consensus has come up a few times. So I'm wondering, on this important issue, are all the citizens in Cape Elizabeth getting a vote or something on this? I mean, there's so many people that are interested in this, and it's important to so many people. I mean, I just want to know how this goes, how this is going to happen.
How this will happen is that the town council will make the final vote on this, and what I'm anticipating is that that vote will take place at the council's meeting in September, which is September 9th. We do not have a town meeting form of government. We have the council here representing the citizens, and it will be the council who makes the final vote.
All right.
We certainly listen to people tonight at this public hearing. We'll have another public hearing in September.
And will that be more publicized, maybe? So one gentleman brought up that point that he didn't know about it till this evening. I mean, is there, because this is going to be the final hearing, you say?
We have no control over what the Cape Courier and the Portland Press Herald put out. This meeting was on the council agenda that was on the cable TV channel, I believe. It was announced at last month's council meeting that there would be a public hearing this evening. When? Okay, after our last workshop on June 24th, there was a front page article in the Portland Press Herald. Is that right? And it did include the information that there would be a public hearing tonight.
Right, okay.
Yeah,
well,
we do our best.
My question. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who has new information or a question that we can answer for you at this point? Okay, I will say that the public hearing is now closed and open this to the council. We have four items before us this evening. To get my papers organized anyway. I think I've lost my agenda. Yeah. Okay, item number 32, consideration of playing field sites. I would entertain a motion and then we can have discussion. Councillor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I move that we consider the previously read by the chair proposal for playing field sites.
Second, I move.
Thank you. Council discussion. Councillor Cogsell.
Yes, I'd like to offer a motion, an amendment for clarification, that in the reference be it further ordered in relation to the Fort Williams Park area, it specifically states alternate number 4. I would like to see that it would read soccer, field hockey, lacrosse.